Well, there's no doubt that the pro and open class cars here at World Time Attack Challenge are exciting to watch. The problem with these cars is that the amount of money that needs to be poured into them makes them completely unrelatable to a lot of home enthusiasts. Now, we're here with Benjamin from Benchmark Solutions with the ERS Mitsubishi Evo running in the Clubsprint class. Now, this Clubsprint class is a very competitive class, very limited on the sort of modifications that can be made. And this means that the cars that are racing are a lot more like what you'd expect to see out on the street or at your local club level race meets. So for a start, we've already covered this car last year, Benjamin. I want to cover some of the changes that have been made to it. But before that, it's probably important to mention that it's going pretty well here at World Time Attack Challenge. How's it placed at the moment?
We're doing really well. Heading into the shootout for Club Sprint, we're currently number one. Just in front of Elusive Racing Integra, so it's been a tight battle.
About two thousandths?
Yeah, about that. It's been back and forth the whole weekend, so it's good fun. Keeps on your toes.
All right, still shootout to go, yeah, so you're going to have to stay on your toes.
They're coming.
Now, in terms of the changes that you've made, let's just start with the problems you sort of were facing last year with the car. Why did you need to make changes?
So last year, as a lot of you would have seen, we had a fire issue. The car basically split a turbo gasket, and that caused an oil line to rupture, burnt the front of the car apart. So it was a rebuild from there, but also focused some changes on areas that would make it more reliable.
So in terms of getting more reliability out of this, this is a problem we do see a lot with turbo gaskets failing. Yep. So how do you deal with that? What have you done?
So we moved away from anything that could fail, so no gaskets and no studs and nuts. So it's now V-band flanges on the turbo to manifold to dump pipe and to wastegate.
It makes sense, but the problem with that is that it takes you away from the ability to run a split pulse exhaust housing. You're kind of confined then to a single entry exhaust housing. There's a pretty good argument there that the split pulse exhaust housing can give improved response with the same size turbocharger compared to a single scroll. So how did that sort of drive your turbo choice?
Okay, so last year we were running the 7670 from EFR BorgWarner, and whilst producing great results, at the same time we had a feeling it was choking on the engine with the RPM required. So this time we've gone to a Garrett Gen 2 3576 in the 8.3 rear. This had little to no losses under the curve before peak boost, and then everywhere from there is gains per pound.
So essentially very similar boost response. You're seeing peak boost around about the same area, but from there on more power?
Yeah, so it's about 2 to 250 RPM if you're just measuring pound for pound, but the torque differences are quite close. So even though the boost threshold's a little bit later, the torque delivery, you don't feel it, and the extra flow in the turbine side is just another level.
And the other thing here we do need to consider is turbo sizing for a circuit car where the driver knows for any given corner, any part of the track, what gear they're going to be in. Generally, you're staying in a higher rev range. So I wouldn't say that boost response is irrelevant, but a little bit less of a consideration compared to a street car where response is so critical.
Definitely.
Is that fair?
Yeah, it is. And this track is definitely the largest out of all the tracks this car races on. So boost response is a very big key still, because the other tracks further down south are a lot more focused on tighter and corner exits. So we were a little bit concerned how it would affect, because this is once a year event here, but the rest of the events are held on tighter tracks. But it hasn't been as bad as what we initially thought.
All right, so in terms of power and boost, what are you actually running? Where did you get to?
Yeah, so on the EFR, we're around 380 kilowatts of the wheels, just under 400. The Garrett, we're able to get a bit more out of it. So we're at 440 on about 36, 37 pound.
And is that basically all in? There's nothing left in it?
Yeah, no, we're out of compressor. The turbine still wants to keep going, but the compressor's, all over.
Is there actually going to be benefits in this class with the limitations on making more power, or sort of does it become a diminishing return there?
Yeah, interesting point. So I've been working with the driver. We actually were pulling power out of the car. Now we rectify the engine issues. We pulled power back to gate pressure, about 290 to 300, and we were making suspension and driver changes, focusing on that because we found we were going backwards, adding more power in. And once we rectified that and the driver got dialed in suspension chassis, we were at our PB level on 110 kilowatts less boost.
I think that's a really important point you make that's so easily overlooked. A lot of people go to the racetrack and try and fix problems with a poor lap time by just adding more power. But of course, if you've got a car that's not handling right, add more power and it just makes a bad handling car just even worse, which can be dangerous. Now, you just mentioned some engine issues. So can you talk us through that side of things?
So we had this engine was quite reliable for nearly 18 months. Did quite a few track days, was pushed hard. We suspect we had a cracked head last week on testing and kind of validated that on Monday, just out of control temperatures and coolant pressures. So the boys at ERS pulled an all-nighter this week and they had a spare 2.3 crate motor on the stand, so we put that in, which I think we talked about running that later in the year, just with extra capacity for the tighter tracks and the different turbo choice. It's worked really well. The head now is a lot better. It's put together by Micks Motorsports again. Slightly different head package, a little bit more compression, a little bit more capacity, and the cam size has stepped up to match the inlet manifold, and yeah, so.
Are you still running the MIVEC cam control?
Yeah, variable cam control. With the larger cam though, it's really working exceptional now to make use of the RPM range.
With the larger cam, does that actually limit the amount of movement you can use on the inlet cam, or are you still allowed the maximum?
No, so I pulled it back 5 degrees just because of the maximum. So it's basically set a cam limit. And I think like mid 20 degrees is now instead of about 32, 33.
So. All right, so in terms of the rest of the system there as well, you've made some changes to the intercooler plumbing and specifically around the throttle body, which is interesting because I see a lot of debate about throttle body sizing, a lot of people going with just basically bigger is better. Not always the way. Can you give us your insight on that?
Yeah, so I basically like to size the throttle body off similar to your turbo inducer size on your compressor. So the car was running an 82mm Bosch drive-by-wire on a hypertune plenum. A lot of thought around just adjusting the throttle plate angle to effectively reduce the size of the throttle. In our experience, it doesn't always work and it's not too effective. So we actually have gone down to a 68mm throttle body, downsize the intercooler piping again to match, down nearly an inch in size. So about 300 to 400 RPM of torque gained in the lower end of the rev range.
So I think most people at 440 kilowatts at the wheels would probably think, on face value, 68mm throttle body is too small. You don't feel that's restricting your own power at all?
No, it's actually probably a bit too big. We would like to have gone out to a 58 to 60 mil, but it just wasn't available from Bosch. Off the shelf, 68 mil is easy to work with, readily available for parts. It's a good compromise because we think the car will probably end up with a bigger turbo. It might probably go to a G35 when they come out, so.
Sounds like a natural progression. All right, talking about the rest of the car there, in terms of the transmission, what are you running?
It runs an Albans H-pattern dog engagement.
So you're limited in the Clubsprint Class to non-sequential gearboxes?
Yeah, that's correct. So it's got a state H-pattern gearbox. This year we've added a Hollinger HGK H flat shift knob. So that's running through the MoTeC M150 flat upshift changes. Driver can just keep it pinned and just grab gears. So.
A little bit more challenging with the H-pattern shift pattern though with those flat shifts, because if you get it wrong, you can end up going straight from the top of, let's say, fourth gear back down into the wrong gear. Not really a good look.
Yeah, no, it's interesting. On the dyno, it's always a bit of a pucker moment the first few times you grab the gears. And then testing on the roads, it's interesting. You've got to commit with the H pattern and you just got to just send it to the next gear. Luckily, you try not to do it with the customer next year, basically.
Now, in terms of the rest of the transmission there, you've also got a controllable centre diff, centre diff. Yep. And I just want to get some insight into how you're using that with the MoTeC ECU in terms of controlling it and where the benefits are.
Yeah, so the ECU takes all the chassis inputs. So we've got four wheel speeds, steering angle, your normal brake and throttle, and some G inputs. It then uses that to determine clamp load based on acceleration and braking and steering angle. And then the driver has on the keypad a multi-position driver switch, so he can run up to 9 different diff maps. We usually use 2 to 3 around the track depending on how he's feeling and the track condition. It's actually really effective. It works exceptionally. It's been one of the biggest changes once we've dialed that in nicely to us consistently running good times.
In terms of the electronic side of that, are you running a separate diff controller or are you integrating this with the ECU?
No, it's all integrated in the M150. It handles everything.
So that's the MoTeC M150, just for those who aren't following along?
Yeah, MoTeC M150. It runs a custom firmware from an Australian company. Everything's all in-house. The dash is just display. Everything's through the ECU.
So again, just for those who kind of really aren't familiar with the M150, it's quite unique in that really you can buy it from MoTeC with off-the-shelf firmware to run most things, and then you've also got the ability to buy a custom firmware or write your own custom firmware to do what you want, and that's what you're talking about here. So this isn't something that is available from MoTeC, this is a third-party firmware package?
Yeah, that's right. So MoTeC have their own MDC diff controller, which is really effective. We just like to have everything in the one house for loggability and tunability, and then we've just found that while the MoTeC packages cover everything nicely, for applications like this where you want a little bit more control in the central location, it works exceptionally well.
Sounds like a great package. Look, you've got the shootout coming up. It's great to hear a little bit more about the car. We wish you all the best and hopefully you can stay on top. Cheers for the chat.
Thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.